is not here yet, but he will be soon. His case was the first capital conviction to be overturned as a result of DNA testing, testing in the United States. In 1984, Kirk Bloodsworth was convicted of sexual assault, rape, and first-degree murder of a 9-year-old girl. He was sentenced to death, but his original conviction was overturned, and he was retried and reconvicted and then sentenced to 2 consecutive life terms in prison. But in 1993, as a result of DNA testing, his conviction was overturned and he was released from prison. And in December 1993, the governor of Maryland pardoned him. What happens in these cases, though, is that notwithstanding that the individual has been exonerated as a result of DNA or otherwise, many people, or at least some people, continue to believe that he must have had something to do with it. I think the our ideals about the criminal justice system are so strong that there is a notion that we really don't get it wrong. And I think it's startling to some of us the extent to which we do get it wrong in cases. In this case, almost miraculously, September 2003, DNA testing was used to identify another man as the rapist and murderer in the case in which Kurt was convicted. And as a result, his is one of those rare cases where the person, in fact, is totally exonerated. Ironically, as a result of DNA being used to identify the actual perpetrator. That happened here in North Carolina in the Darrell Hunt case, where DNA was used to identify the person who actually committed the crime. Mr. Bloodsworth is a crab fisherman on the Maryland shore, and he's also spending a lot of time as an advocate for reform of the criminal justice system. His ordeal is the subject of a new biography, and it's called Bloodsworth, that was written by Tim Junkin, who is a Maryland lawyer and a writer. He says that he spends about 50% of his time on cases and 50% of his time writing. He's an alum of the Dream Team public defenders in Washington, D.C., along with Bob Mosteller on the faculty here and Rich Rosen in Chapel Hill and a lot of other lawyers who are renowned for their skills. It's a pleasure for me to welcome Tim and eventually to welcome Kirk Bloodsworth to Duke. Let me just say before Tim starts that the Regulator Book Store is going to be here after this program, and they have copies of the biography, and Kirk and Tim will be pleased to sign them for you if you'd like. So, Tim. Welcome to Duke.
Thank you very much, and thanks to Duke Law School for having me and Kirk. You all, I think most of you all are law students, and you read cases, a lot of cases. I think it's going to be a treat for you to actually see in person a man who was the victim of our criminal justice system. I think you'll be amazed at what an impression he'll make on you. This is not really a biography I wrote. It's a story of his case. I was a public defender in the 70s with Bob and Mosteller and a number of other people, and went into private practice. And back when I was, before I went to law school, I grew up on the eastern shore of Maryland, the Chesapeake Bay area, and I spent a year trying to be a waterman. The term waterman means fisherman, crabber, oysterman on the bay, and it was way too difficult, so I just went to law school to find something easy to do. I was just in private practice when I heard the story that an Eastern Shore waterman had been arrested and charged with the rape, mutilation, torture, and murder of a 9-year-old girl. And I remember back thinking at the time, it was 1984, that it just didn't make sense to me because I had spent so many days and months and years with watermen growing up. It just seemed incompatible. That may seem like a sort of a naive notion, but it struck me wrong. And then I lost track of the story. I was very busy practicing law. And my first novel, which I wrote in 1999, was called The Waterman. And my second book was set on the Chesapeake Bay as well, which is called Good Counsel. After writing those two books, I was looking for a nonfiction project, and I came across another article about that same waterman that I'd heard about in 1984. His name was Kirk Bloodsworth. I didn't know much about it, except in this article, it talked about how he'd been exonerated and how difficult it had been for him to come out of prison and try to reenter his community, a small waterman's town called Cambridge, Maryland. But the fact that he was from the place that I like to write about and that he was a waterman and that I had been involved with death penalty work myself in private practice, it all seemed to gel. And I approached Kirk and I asked him if he would tell me his story, that I wanted to write a book on the history of what happened to him. And I offered to share the proceeds with him if he would agree to do that, and he did. There were so many things. And here's Kirk and Brenda coming in right now, so you'll have a chance to meet Kirk in a few minutes. There were so many things I didn't know about the story when I began getting involved in it. In 1984, on a hot summer July day, actually a pretty day like this, in a community just outside of Baltimore, Dawn Venice Hamilton was 9 years old, and about 11 o'clock in the morning she was playing with some friends when she disappeared. Her guardian went looking for her. When she couldn't find her, two little boys, 10 and 7, told her that Dawn had been taken into the woods by a strange man. Over 200 police began canvassing the area searching for Dawn Hamilton. About 2 o'clock in the afternoon that day, they found her body. She was nude from the waist down. Her head had been crushed. Her throat had been stepped on so hard that there were footprints in her throat. She had been sodomized, raped, and murdered, and a stick had been inserted inside her that pierced her internal organs. You can imagine the horror and outcry of the community to find the monster who could commit such a crime. Police began working with these two boys to try to create composite sketches. At that same time, Kirk Bloodsworth was about 23 years old. He was a decorated Marine who'd never been arrested for anything in his life. He had left Cambridge because he'd been in a difficult marriage, and he had married a woman 10 years older than he was, and they'd been married about a month, and she left. She didn't like Cambridge, and she'd gone to Baltimore, and he'd gone up to try to find her and fix up the marriage, and he was up in the Baltimore area for about a month around the time this crime occurred. A few days after the crime occurred, Kirk gave up on his wife and went back to Cambridge. He knew nothing, had nothing to do with it, knew nothing about it, except it was all over the news, and he heard about it like everybody else did. People say to me, you know, how is it that a man who's never been arrested for anything could be targeted, indicted, tried, convicted, and sentenced to death for a crime he had nothing to do with? Well, as you all know, it's happening now. I mean, we're seeing that it's happened more and more often. But this book sets out the entire police investigation. I was able to gather together literally all of the thousands of pages of police reports, the FBI reports. The FBI did an FBI psychological profile, trying to identify characteristics of the monster who would commit such a crime as this, which profiling back then in 84 was sort of a brand new art, and they did a profile. Part of the profile was it would be a man who perhaps hated women because he was in a relationship dominated by women. Well, Kirk Bloodsworth had married a woman who was 10 years older than he was. Part of the profile was that the killer would leave the area probably within 2 or 3 days after the crime, well, Kirk Bloodsworth, for reasons that had nothing to do with the crime, of course, left the area. And there were other aspects of this kind of a voodoo science way of sort of trying to identify a killer that unfortunately were used in this case. But if you look at the book or the story, you can see how these two very experienced homicide detectives with tremendous amount of pressure on them to solve this crime, and they had available to them hundreds of police officers to use, how they came to believe wrongly that Kirk Bloodsworth was the man who killed and mutilated this little girl. Kirk was arrested in Cambridge. He'll tell you a little bit about it. Didn't even know what it was about. Taken in handcuffs without any clothes except for a pair of shorts, put in police cars, and told by dozens and dozens and dozens of police that he was the son of a bitch who did this to this little girl. And so he became the second victim of this terrible crime. When I first approached Kirk, I didn't know that he was tried not once, but twice. First time he was tried, he had a court-appointed lawyer, five alibi witnesses, character witnesses, a man who was a Pan-American, his Kirk's coach, who was a Pan-American discus champion, came in and testified in the court, trying to support Kirk. The government, by the time the first trial rolled around, had five adult identification witnesses, including the two boys, who took the stand, pointed their finger at Kirk Bloodsworth, said, "That's the man we saw by the pond with the little girl." Now, you all study identification issues, I'm sure, in your classes, and how difficult they can be and how fraught with problems they can be, and this is a classic example. Several of these witnesses, before they went to a lineup, were contacted by the police, and the police told them, "Please don't watch the television over the weekend, because the suspect you're going to see on Monday in the lineup is going to be all over the news, handcuffed, surrounded by police officers." What do you think happened then? People were glued to the TV. Came in the lineup. Who else are they going to pick out? How do jurors, when faced with a trial of a man who raped, murdered, tortured a little girl, and who know that the police believe he's guilty, and the prosecutors believe he's guilty, and the judge believe he's guilty, how are they going to let him go? Pressures of this kind of a case really invert the reasonable doubt standard, I think. I mean, it's just human nature. When Kirk Bloodsworth was sentenced by the judge sentenced him to die in Maryland's gas chamber. The courtroom was packed, and it erupted in cheering. People were screaming, clapping, "Give him the gas," as Kirk fell to his knees. Couldn't understand why people would be cheering, because when they had the wrong man, when he was an innocent man, but nobody would listen. When I first met Kirk Bloodsworth, I had no idea what his experience was like to be thrown into one of the most violent and notorious prisons in America, the South Wing of the Maryland Penitentiary, branded a child rapist and child killer. There are two chapters in this book which are bone-chilling chapters about what his experiences were, trying to just survive in that place. He was the mark. A week before he got into the prison, a guard had been disemboweled by an inmate over a perceived insult, so all the guards wore knife vests when Kirk was put in this place. And he was only kept in solitary for about 2 months, and then he was let out in general population. And the things he had to do to survive, I don't think you can read this book without asking yourself, would I have even survived this, let alone triumphed and prevailed? He never stopped fighting. The Maryland Court of Appeals, which is the highest court in Maryland, threw out the conviction because of prosecutorial misconduct. The prosecutors, once again, withheld information that was exculpatory. And I know a bunch of you probably will become prosecutors. And this is a cautionary tale, because we need prosecutors in this country who turn over evidence, who don't get caught up in winning every case. It's not a game, as the judge, the second judge who tried Kirk Bloodsworth, when he admonished the prosecutors after the second trial, when again they withheld exculpatory evidence, "It's not a game," he said. you have a higher duty as prosecutors. You're supposed to be seeking truth, and you're supposed to be seeking justice. And you have to constantly reexamine what you're doing and your beliefs. I think this book is about people in power and how easy it is to get sort of lost in the arrogance and cocksureness of your decisions when you are in power. I didn't know that about the second trial, but when Kirk was tried the second time, his father mortgaged his house. His parents took out their savings accounts. They sold their cars. They raised every penny they had and took everything they had to hire the best lawyer that they knew that they heard about. Private lawyer this time. A real fancy lawyer. Came in and tried the case entirely differently. Entirely different defense strategy. Two entirely different trials. Jury went out. 6 hours later, came back. Guilty again. Kirk was sent back to the same hole he'd been in for 2 years. This time his appeal was denied. Maryland Court of Appeals was just not going to put the victim, I think, and the victim's family, or excuse me, the victim's family through a third trial. And the lawyers told Kirk, and they told him he was done. Second judge gave him consecutive life sentences. The second judge had some qualms about the verdict. So what he did was he took the little girl's panties and clothes and the stick, and he knew that after the appeal was over in Maryland, the evidence would be destroyed after a period of time, so he took those items and he put them in his closet in his chambers because he was so disturbed about the verdict. A little miracle in this case. The FBI, when they examined the little girl's panties, came in 1985 in the first trial and testified, "We've examined these clothes and there's no identifiable semen on any of the clothes." FBI. What happened was Kirk never stopped fighting. Every single day in prison, no matter what his condition was, he wrote letters to people. He signed every one, Kirk Bloodsworth, A period, I period, M period, an innocent man. Every day. He finally found a lawyer named Bob Morin, who's now a Superior Court judge in Washington, who believed Kirk was innocent and took his case on. Right around that time, Kirk read a book by Joseph Wambaugh, the LA crime writer. It's called The Blooding, and it detailed the first use of DNA ever to solve a crime. Kirk contacted his lawyer and said, "You know, maybe DNA can save me." The lawyer said, looked into it. They did a bunch of research. "Yeah, but there's nothing to test." The FBI said there were no fluids. There was no foreign blood. There were swabs taken of the little girl. There were no semen samples. There were no semen on the clothes. "Please, Bob, don't give up." Morin finds the clothes in the judge's chambers. Finds a lab in California willing to test it. A new kind of DNA test. This is like 1989. DNA is still not really well known then, but there's some new tests that can take very small samples and amplify it. You all are probably studying that. It was called PCR. Morin convinces the prosecutors, who think it's a big joke, to let the clothes be tested. Sends it out to a lab. Contrary to what the FBI examiner testified to, there was a semen stain the size of a quarter on the little girl's pants. They tested it. Came back. Not Kirk Bloodsworth. They let him out. They let him out, and you know what the prosecutor said when they let him out? They had a press conference. "This evidence undercuts the integrity of the conviction. We're not sure that there is now reasonable doubt to hold this man, but we're not prepared to say he's innocent." Kirk Bloodsworth goes back to Cambridge, and everybody doesn't know. Nobody knows what DNA is. They think it's a little legal quick step. They think it's some kind of technicality. People leave notes on his truck. Child murderer, child killer. Nobody wants him in their neighborhood. But Kirk he's just begun. Not only did he want to free himself, he realized that he was tied at the hip with Dawn Hamilton, and he was determined to find out who her actual killer was. So he began to pester the state's attorney in Baltimore County to take that DNA and put it in the state data bank, put it in the county data bank, put it in a national data bank, put it in the CODIS. For 10 years, he could not convince them to do this. Now, if Kirk Bloodsworth is the wrong man, that means the real killer and the real murderer is somewhere else, right? They could afford to try him twice, to fight his appeals twice, to fight the DNA, but they told him they couldn't afford, they didn't have the funds to put it in the data bank. Kirk worked at it. He got Bob Morin, he got Barry Scheck, he got other lawyers to put pressure on the prosecutors, and finally, in 2003, they put the DNA in the data bank. Pop. They find the real killer. Turns out it was a man who was in the same prison tier as Kirk Bloodsworth for 5 years, who lifted weights with him, a man who would never look him in the eye, a man who just this past March pled guilty to the crime, admitted he did it by himself, and because Kirk Bloodsworth did not want the death penalty imposed, he was sentenced to two consecutive life sentences. When I first approached Kirk Bloodsworth, I think probably the most astonishing thing I didn't know about him was what he had done with his life after he got out of prison. Here is this man who was the victim of profound injustice, and what I learned was is that Kirk Bloodsworth has turned his life into one of our most positive forces for justice and has become one of the most forceful spokesperson in our country for prison reform, against the death penalty. He's testified in over half of our state legislatures for DNA testing funds, for DNA testing for inmates who are locked up, for rape victims who can't get their rape kits tested. He testified in front of Congress a half a dozen or a dozen times. There's a bill right now that's passed the House and pending in the Senate that's named after him. This past March, he was flown over to London, England, to appear along with the man who invented the DNA fingerprints, Sir Alec Jeffries, in front of a televised audience of 10 million Brits. He's devoted his life to making sure that this doesn't happen to anybody else. So it's truly an incredible story, a cautionary tale, but one that deserves to be heard. It's a story that it's just full of little miracles, and I think it's a treat for you today to have the opportunity to meet in person Kirk Bloodsworth.
I can find, by the way, I'm sorry I'm late. I can find my way off death row, but I can't find Duke University. Anyhow, in 1984, my life was a lot different. I was newly married, just got out of the Marine Corps, honorably discharged. I was the Marine Corps discus champion for 3 years. I was on the all-Marine track team, threw the discus for them and also the shot put. I envisioned someday that I would be going to a university just like this under a track scholarship. But that was never to happen. And this story that I'm about ready to tell you is a little humorous to me now. However, at the time, it wasn't so funny. My first lawyer, he was a public defender, and he came to see me. And I want you to play me, and I'll be him. And I want you to understand this. There was two archway doors separating the visiting room. And there was a big cinder block wall right behind him. Okay, just keep that in mind. And he comes up to me and he says, Kirk, he says, I know my way around criminal justice, and I know my way around this system. And we're going to find our way out of this problem, because you're in trouble. Yes. And I'll find your way out of here, and I'll find a way out for both of us, and we're going to find our way through this whole system. So he talks to me for about another 20 minutes, still telling me the same rhetoric, and says, he gets up and puts his hand on the glass, and he says, Kirk, I know my way around the criminal justice system, and I know my way around the Baltimore County justice system, and we're going to find our way out of this thing. He grabs his briefcase, throws his coat over his shoulder, and runs right into the wall. I'm done. But the rest of it isn't so funny. Knock came on my door at 2:45 in the morning. The house was surrounded by police officers, all guns drawn, lights just a blaring. Opened the door and I asked him, I said, what can I do you for? There he is. I turned around just as a reflex, thinking they were looking for somebody else in the house. No, they weren't. Said, you Kirk Bloodsworth? I said, yes, I am. You're under arrest for first-degree murder of Dawn Venice Hamilton, you son of a bitch. Huh? You got the wrong guy. That's when it all began for me. 2:45 in the morning on August 9th, 1984. They put me in a police car. They questioned me for 3 hours. They took my hair, my pubic, my blood, and everything else. Took pictures of me. They said the witnesses were looking for a man that was 6'5", curly blonde hair, bushy mustache, tan skin, and skinny. Okay. That's never been me. In 1984, I weighed 225, and I've got red hair, and I burn. I'm a waterman. I'm fair complected, and as most people know, with people with freckles. But I worked in the water all my life, and they just had the wrong guy. I'm not going to really get into that, but just remember what I just said about the ID, because it's going to be important later. So I went through the first trial. People came there, unfamiliar to me. You know, people that I met for the first time, like you guys. Never seen them before in my life. And they were going, that's him, right there. The two main eyewitnesses in the case was an 8-year-old and a 10-year-old little boy. They were looking up at this man on a bright sunny day at 10 a.m. with the sun behind his face up on a rise of a hill. They were fishing in a pond, you see, and they were catching sunnies, little sun perch. They caught a turtle. The guy came down, was really interested in what they caught. Even touched their tackle box. Nobody ever checked it for prints up to that point. So they said that he walked off into the woods with the little girl. We seen him go. The time of the trial came. He's no longer 6'5" and skinny. He's 6 foot something and burly. I find it very peculiar how that changed. I had a lineup. Witnesses never even picked me out of the lineup until 2 weeks later. Called in, it was number 6. We were scared. I can understand that. 2 little boys, this is a high-profile case, and this man is charged with first-degree murder of Dawn Hamilton. Dawn Hamilton, and Tim alluded to a lot of this, and her head was crushed, literally, with a rock. Her throat was stepped on. She was naked from the waist down and had a stick inserted in it so far it punctured her mucosa of her rectum and was left there in her panties and shorts thrown in a tree. That's a god-awful crime. 200-some COPE officers and police force went out in massive search for this man, as they should. That's a 9-year-old little girl. We gotta find him. There was a police report that came over the desk right around the first part of August that said you need to look at this guy. He was charged with a rape of 2 girls in Baltimore. His name was Kimberly. You need to look at him. This came down from Baltimore City. Your police report remained dormant. The two never talked. August 9th, I was arrested and went to court. One of the loneliest feelings, as Tim was saying a while ago, is after they convicted me and the prosecutor called, there he is, that's the monster. Look at those eyes. Remember what the boys said about the eyes. And all I could do was wait and listen to all these accusations. My first night in prison, I sat there after the guilty verdict came back and everybody just started cheering. They stayed up until 4 o'clock in the morning and partied in bars all over Essex, Maryland, happy and gleeful for my execution that was pending. But just like some people have passed, they did not know what they were doing. I sat there in this prison cell and heard that door clank with the sound like a dump truck dropping the gate back. It just went boom in my ears. I had a styrofoam cup full of what was supposed to be spaghetti, and it had a half-boiled tomato in it. I threw it back and fell down onto my bed and just wept until I went to sleep. I was so exhausted mentally. The Marine Corps and anything else I had ever done had never, ever prepared me for this, but in some ways. I sat there the next night, like night after night, just wondering what the heck was going to happen. One time I slept in a part of the jail where the gas chamber is located one floor above my head. And the guards came down and they asked me, said, "Kirk, you want to go on a paint detail? We got a paint detail for you. You can go around and you can help us out." And I said, "Sure, anything to get out of the cell. You know, I wanted to get out and just stretch my legs and do something." "Well, come on upstairs to the death chamber. We need you to paint it for your arrival so it can be nice and pretty, Captain Kirk." One of many, many brutal statements and comments that I got over the years. One night I sat there and the power went off in jail. They would do torturous things to you. It was just like this psychological warfare that was going on between the powers that be and the inmates. It was wintertime. They'd open the windows up. It was summertime, 100 and some degrees in there, and they would close the windows. I had my temperature was taken in my cell, and it was 115 degrees one time. And I was on the fifth tier. So we all know what heat does. It was so bad, the pictures on my wall of my parents and some of my friends were just rippled from the thick humidity in the air. I had to stick my feet in the toilet to keep myself cool. Wash my socks in the toilet, wash my hair in the toilet. I ate 2 feet away from my toilet in a place that had nothing but filth and brutality around it 24/7. I sat in this place one night and the power went off. And it may tell you how spooky that is when you're in prison and there's no lights around. It was pitch dark. You couldn't see your hand in front of your face. And then I was laying there in my bunk and I felt these things hitting me all over my body. I said, "What the heck was it?" I just thought maybe it might have been the paint falling off the roof or somebody was jumping up and down on the next floor. The lights came back. They were cockroaches falling on me, and there was 1,000 on the ceiling running everywhere. I had to shove cotton in my ears to keep the roaches from going in there and laying eggs. Rats, mice, urine. I had a guy one time, he heard what I had been put in there for, and he took one of them soap bottles, you know, the kind you wash dishes with, and filled it up with urine and fecal matter and squirted it all over me and my Bible. This is how the hatred that I had to endure for 8 years, 11 months, and 19 days, 2 years on death row. And if that's just a piece of it. That was every day. People ask me what prison's like. I said, "Well, I can tell you, eat a pack of razor blades for breakfast, lunch, and dinner, and you might get close, because it's a bad, bad place. Oz and the rest of the shows on TV give it no justice at all." That's almost too surreal for me. I mean, this place was brutal with a capital B. But then I got tired of feeling sorry and tired of myself and the way I was going. So I started to read. I became the prison librarian. I read every book. I read 3,000 books in prison and wrote that many letters. 3,000 books, everything from Stephen King to Gestalt psychology. Now, that last one, I have no idea. It was the only book in my cell. It's as dry as the Mojave. And I couldn't tell you. I think it's about quantum thinking or something. But I just wanted to do something. And then I got this stack of books in my, you know, for one of them Columbia things. You know, you get 4 books and they sell them to you for a penny. But I never did it. I don't know where he came from. I think it was the guy that had my cell before. But on the top of the book was a book called The Bloody. And I said, well, that's interesting. It's kind of like in my name. I'm going to read it. I just something to do, you know. If I had Louis L'Amour, I probably would have read that. But I opened it up, and I started reading, and I started turning these pages and started learning about this guy named Alec Jeffries and this technology he had come up with. He found out a way to decode, to make the genetic code, which makes you different from her and her different from him. Up to 1 million different tests were done on this kind of technology. And if you want to talk to me later, I'll tell you who I can owe my debt to on that, because it'll surprise you. Because Alec Jeffries, when I went over there at the Pride of Britain Awards, told me it came from a gray seal in the Antarctic. And I'll tell you about that later. But then I had my second trial. My case was overturned on exculpatory evidence. It was about another suspect. They had another suspect in the case that reportedly came to a mental health clinic with scratches on his face the day of the murder, saying he had a problem with a little girl, and the state didn't think I deserved to have that. That's not exculpatory enough. No. You had to have been eating lunch with the Pope. Something like that. But needless to say, I got this DNA test done. In 1992, we sent them out after the second trial, and I was very hopeful that, you know, he said, oh, by the way, you remember that stain that the FBI said wasn't on there? It's there. You know, and not only did we find one stain, the FBI found another one when they got their DNA lab online. There was only two that was really certifiable in this country at that time, and that was forensic science. There was one in Boston, but he was so backlogged, and then FBI just came online after my test came back a year later. Well, the results were in. This next, I've been talking a lot to universities and colleges and the people in general. And I can't tell you how much this next thing disturbs me and bothers me deeply. And my mother died 3 months before my DNA test came back. And I had to go to her, view her body in handcuffs and shackles. That was one of the saddest things of this whole ordeal for me personally. She loved her son and believed in him wholeheartedly and never, ever gave up on me because she knew the boy she raised. And I thank her a lot because guess what? She taught me how to read, not my teachers. She did. Because if I didn't listen to her, she'd kick my butt. She taught me to read stories from the Bible and different stories. I even read People in Low Places and different things that she would never let me read. Peyton Place, put that down. But I was just absolutely enthralled by reading. And it was because of her that I picked up a book called The Blooding. It saved my life. In June the 28th, 1993, I stepped out of prison a free man. At least I thought it was. The state's attorney's office said, if we had this evidence back in 1984, we wouldn't prosecute Mr. Bloodsworth. However, we're not prepared to say he's innocent. I do not know how you can throw it back at the person you let loose when it's the obligation of the prosecution to prove their case. The burden of proof is always on the state, not on the defendant. They should never, ever throw that back at me. And then for 11 years, I was vilified. People calling me on the phone, I'm going to kill you. I'm going to kill you. I'm going to kill you for what you did to that little girl. You got away with it. They thought it was some shaman science. You know, people are unknown from my neighborhood and from my area. I was working one place when I first got out to a place called Clean Water Action. You go door to door and solicit money for clean water and clean air. Oh, I thought that was a great job. People, you know, get some respect. I went to this one door, knocked on the guy's door. He came to the door. And he's a little short fellow, and he come up to me. He says, you're that guy that was in prison, aren't you? Yes. We don't want your kind in the neighborhood. He threw my clipboard back at me. I walked down the driveway, and as I was doing, he's going, child murder in the neighborhood, at the top of his lungs on a Friday night when everybody was out in the street. He called the sheriff. The sheriff called my work. I had to quit. I got my first job. They made me bring my pardon, my release papers, and everything else. You know, in that little place, have you ever been convicted of a crime? And I said, yeah, but I didn't do it. How are you going to fight that? So I got a pardon from the governor of the state of Maryland, William Donald Schaefer, signed my pardon so I could get compensated. That was the only way I could get compensated in the state. I got $300,000, which comes to about $9.97 a day for my trouble. Later on, I always tried to get more and get a job, but Baltimore County wouldn't kick in. 94, 95, 96, 97, they still saying I did it. 98, 99, 2000, 2001, 02, and then the bullet came. I got this frantic phone call from Baltimore County, Maryland. I don't get phone calls from Baltimore County, Maryland. And I'm looking at the phone, and I'm going, who is this? I answer the phone. I said, hello. And the voice came back, can I speak to Kirk Bloodsworth? And I said, who's calling? And they said, Ann Bropes, assistant attorney, prosecutor, Baltimore County, the woman that called me a monster and sent me to death row. I was ready to fall out. So I said the only thing I thought I could say, what can I do for you? She said, I want to talk to you about the Hamilton case and update you about it. I said, tell me. Well, I want to tell you in person. And we'll meet you any place you want to do, any place you want to meet. Well, can't come to my house. So the only other place we can meet at is the Burger King in Cambridge. So I met her there along with my lawyer. This time, she was in tow, my wife and my cousin. She said, we had a hit on CODIS. It came in 24 hours. The cold hit came in 24 hours, and while she sat there, the positive hit came in 10. That it was a guy by the name of Kimberly Shea Ruffner who slept right underneath me for years. He would never look me in the eye. He would never really cast his gaze at me. He would always kind of turn. And these things you think about after, you know, you look back in hindsight, of some of the kind of things it was. Anybody want to take a real good guess on how tall he was? 5'7", 170 pounds. Much shorter than me. I mean, they got it. When they got it wrong, they got it wrong. And this is what can happen to us, folks. I don't want to sit here for 1 minute and tell you that I am not for law enforcement, because that would be a bald-faced lie. I'm a card-carrying member of the Fraternal Order of Police. I was a military police officer in the Marine Corps. I respect the law, and you should go to jail if you commit a crime against us. Yes, you should. But let's get it right. There's 3,500 men and women on death rows throughout this country. By the current statistics alone, since people have been released since 1976 who have been found innocent, it's one out of eight people sitting on there that are probably innocent as they can be. That makes it about 300 and something. You go by those odds. Well, if you were going to take a plane ride or a bus trip or anything, and the bus was going to crash one out of eight times, what would you do? You'd stop getting that bus, take the thing offline, get straight. Well, finally, I'm making a little headway. The Kirk Bloodsworth post-conviction DNA testing program flew through the House the other day, and it's going to go to the Senate floor. The Debbie Smith backlog rape kit testing program is going to go to the floor. There's 300,000 rape kits in this country that are untested. In California, a couple years ago, they took 1,800 rape kits and threw them in a garbage can. There's 300,000 rape victims, 300,000 rapists, and 300,000 families that don't know squat. But we, you know why they say they can't do it? The same thing Ann Brope said to me when I asked her, why didn't you do the test 11 years ago? We don't have the money. Well, honey, you're getting ready to get it. And I want everybody to understand that I am so scared that this is why I do this thing. This is why I come to talk to people. This is why I speak out. Because let's face it, if it can happen to a country boy who had no criminal record, no criminal history, a former Marine, honorably discharged, a Christian school attendant person, it can happen to you. Thank you very much.
Do you have time for some questions, or if anybody would have any questions for Kirk or myself, please speak up.
Come on, don't be shy.
There's one of them.
I was just wondering what types of reforms, other than getting rid of the death penalty, you would advocate.
Say that again,
what
dear.
What types of reforms in the criminal justice system? I mean, what types of reforms could?
Oh, well, we're trying to get the DNA testing done in post-conviction, and just in pretrial, and add these offenders, just like when you take. When you commit a crime in this country, you got to do a fingerprint. Well, give them your DNA, too. This is the thing. When you commit a crime, now I'm not saying to come to this young lady now, let me have your DNA, because I think that would be wrong. But if she commits a crime, when they take her fingerprint, they got to take her DNA, too. And I'm supporting stuff like that and helping victims, you know, for reconciliation and trying to make some really broad strokes in criminal justice reform, not only in my state, but across the country.
Let me just add to something about that. I mean, I think North Carolina is doing some great, great things with new legislation you all have passed regarding discovery, requiring prosecutors and police to provide their entire file to defense counsel. I think that's critical. Case after case after case after case, where you find innocent people convicted, are situations where the prosecution has withheld evidence and it isn't discovered until after the trial. And there's absolutely no justification for that. Same thing with eyewitness identification testimony. I think North Carolina is taking the lead on some of those issues, double-blind identification procedures and things like that, to try to bring a little more fairness into the procedure. And I think to try to educate communities and juries about the problems with eyewitness identification are really important. And then again, also the area of confessions and how confessions are often interpreted by law enforcement people or twisted or misstated are big issues. competent counsel is a big issue. Work on those kinds of things, and I think we'll make some real progress. Yes, sir.
Yeah, do you get involved in individual cases? Do you look at them? Do you become an advocate in cases that you think parallel your own? Yes, sir.
Well, you know, I'm trying to do more of a service to, I leave that to the Innocence Project. You know, I'm trying to do more of a service to the broader spectrum of just criminal justice reform in particular. I've taken some cases, and, you know, I just don't have intestinal fortitude to go through another death watch again. I lost Gary Graham in Texas, and sure as I'm standing here, he was an innocent man. And others, you know, across this country, it was just too many, you know, to count. And so I had to go at a different direction. So now I just will holler at senators. It will. As a matter of fact, every senator in U.S. Senate has a copy of this. From Senator Leahy to John Edwards, got a copy of this book.
Of a moratorium on the death penalty?
Yes, I am. I'm against the death penalty.
Anyway.
Period. Yeah. For the simple fact, and this has nothing to do with my current position on the death penalty in general, it has to do with the fact that they could execute an innocent person. That's why. No other reason. You could throw all the other stuff out. If you're going to do that, you know, you might as well forget it. Any other questions? Yes, ma'am.
Mr. Kimberly, what, from the time of the crime until, I guess, he was incarcerated again, what?
Kirk.
You're Kirk. She has
no. The person Kimberly. Who actually did it. What do you know anything about what crimes he had committed in the intervening years when he was out?
Yes, there was two rapes that happened in Baltimore City that he was let go on. So I really can't say that. The victims, the judge said they couldn't prove the case. And they threw it out. He was let go on July 12th, 84, and Dawn Hamilton was murdered on the 25th. And also a woman by knife point that he was convicted of and got 45 years for attempted murder and rape by knife point. In Fells Point, so he was a bad boy.
He was just about to be released into the community when the DNA
he was getting ready to come up for parole
identified him. Well, we hope some of you. Yes.
A quick question. I read the book. It really is wonderful, and you're a wonderful storyteller, Mr. Bloodsworth. One question about Dawn Hamilton's family. Have you ever spoken to them? And what in the book? Talk about the father having had trouble since her murder. Can you talk a little bit about the family of the victim?
Well, the mother has since passed, and the father is, you know, I mean, he's racked up as his 9-year-old child, the only child he had, and he's suffered some setbacks in life, but holds no animosity toward me at all. And I have talked to the guardian that was watching Dawn the day she died, right after, as a matter of fact, the next day after they had convicted Kimberly. And she was just, you know, she's guilt-ridden by the whole thing. And I told her, I said, dear, this is the only, we're both hit by a Mack truck. And we didn't know where it was coming from. And you were caught up in the same deception as everybody else. Except, you know, I was the one that knew, and nobody else knew. She had police officers were telling her that, you know, he did it. He's the guy. Oop, he ain't the guy. And that's exactly, you know, how do you live that? And so she feels like she told me she was sorry. And so I just want them, I think that she can all have some good peace now.
I mean, you know, in writing the book, I decided, Dawn's family suffered a lot of tragedy and embarrassing moments and things like that. And her mother died, and her father had a lot of legal problems. And I really felt like that wasn't the story here, and not to write things that would further embarrass or hurt their family in the book. So it was a decision on my part not to sort of follow through on the tragedy. To them, I think it's fairly obvious as to when this happens, how difficult it is, and when you arrest and convict the wrong person, you're just compounding the harm and the tragedy to the to the family of the victim, and you're also allowing the true killer, the true criminal, to go out and hurt more victims and destroy more families. So every time an innocent person is arrested and convicted, it's a multiple tragedy, because it affects everybody involved, and that's why we got, as lawyers, work so hard to make sure it doesn't happen. So, hope some of you will be interested in getting the book, and thank you all for having us.